Good evening and welcome to the information session for the International Baccalaureate Diploma Program and the Accelerated Learning Program at Georgetown District High School. My name is Kyle Stewart and I am the IB Coordinator at GDHS, and it's a pleasure to be sharing this information with you. I'm sorry that we can't get together in person as we normally would in the auditorium, which allows for the extended and often extensive question and answer period. But I will be available for any questions through email at stewartk@hdsb.ca, or we can speak in person, certainly over the phone. I think the best thing to do is email me with your question and then a phone number, and I will get back to you as soon as I can. I'm often difficult to track down. Before we begin, I would like to honor the land and territory where GDHS sits. So Halton, as we know it today, is rich in history and modern traditions of many First Nations and the Métis. From the Anishinaabe to the Attawatomi, the Haudenosaunee, and the Métis, the lands surrounding the Great Lakes are steeped in Indigenous history. As we gather today on these treaty lands, we have the responsibility to honor and respect the four directions, land, waters, plants, animals, ancestors that walk before us, and all of the wonderful elements of creation that exist. We'd like to acknowledge and thank the Mississaugas of the New Credit First Nation for sharing their traditional territory with us. This was an image taken from what was then called our ISP Integration Day that we now call the ALP program. This is when we get the IB students together with our pre-IB students, and we have a wonderful day of sharing of information and trust activities and community building. But unfortunately, we haven't been able to do that in the last few years because of COVID. A short video for you about Georgetown High School.
Five years ago, I walked out of Georgetown High School. Fond memories then, fond memories today.
Since I was a student here, a lot has changed.
Nothing from the old school is here, except the memories, fond memories of Georgetown High School.
But one thing hasn't changed, the traditions and heritage of the building.
We are Georgetown.
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 Okay, so the IBO, or the International Baccalaureate Organization, was started by a small group of international schools with geographically mobile students, often children of diplomats, different business professionals that their jobs took them around the world. They wanted a common curriculum and an internationally recognized expectations that would uphold to the rigors of post-secondary and allow them the flexibility to move from country to country seamlessly. Today, there are over 1,500,000 IB students at IB World Schools in over 150 different countries. So what is IB? We like this. Teachers with heart and students certainly with desire. So this is kind of an overview of the IB program. So on the left side of the screen, you'll see some adjectives there. And these adjectives make up the IB learner profile. And these are the attributes that we want in IB students, that we try to foster in our IB students. Inquirers, knowledgeable, principled young people that are open-minded and especially caring, but that are also balanced. IB is not just about academics. It's more than that. It's about getting involved in the school community, the community at large. Some of our IB students are the most involved in our school. We don't want students that are in IB that feel that all they can do is study. We want athletes. We want artists. We want socially minded individuals. We want people that are involved in other things other than just academics. So the wheel that you see before you, or the hub, or the IB circle, kind of outlines the program as a whole. We begin with the IB diploma program and the sense of international mindedness as we work towards the center, which is our core. So we have the subject areas there, which are the arts, mathematics, individuals and societies, studies in language and literature, language acquisition, and the sciences. Inside that, we have the core, the three areas that make up the core of IB. That is the theory of knowledge, the extended essay, and the CAS program, creativity, action, and service. So we'll go into a few of those in detail now. So these are the IB subjects and core requirements. So the theory of knowledge, commonly referred to as TOK, is a course in a way of thinking that permeates all courses, that looks at how do we know, the ways of knowing, how and why do we learn the way that we do, kind of peeling back the ideas, has a philosophical undertone. We then have CAS, which is our creativity, action, and service. And this makes up about 150 hours of extracurricular activities that students must do in order to satisfy the diploma. And then we have the extended essay, or the EE. And this is a 4,000 word research project or essay that students must complete, again, to satisfy the IB diploma. The three of these areas are not tied to any of the subjects that we saw in the outer part of the wheel. That's why we call it the core. So for TOK, it is interdisciplinary in nature, and it explores the nature of knowledge across the disciplines. It also encourages an appreciation of other cultural perspectives. So although TOK runs in the second year, one semester of the second year, the TOK principles and the ideas of TOK, again, permeate all subject areas. So although TOK as a standalone may not exist until the second year of IB, we are diving into TOK elements in all of our courses throughout the entire IB diploma. We then have the extended essay, as I mentioned, and this is a maximum 4,000 word essay. We recommend that students at least break that 3,200 mark. And this is where students select a topic that interests them, that coincides with, that links to one of their IB subject areas. They create a research topic of their own. They do independent research, and they essentially craft this essay. They do this with a supervisor of their choosing, and they do that under my general guidance as well as the extended essay and IB coordinator. It's a very important part of the diploma, as it requires that independent research, the writing skills that are going to be necessary at the post-secondary level. So for this year, we're going to be taking our students down to the Toronto Research Library, getting them a membership there so they can tap into all of the online resources that are available. And if they so desire, go down in person as well. They'll be working with our librarian as well on the research component, on the citation component of the essay. So a lot of people kind of come together for the extended essay, as well as their individual supervisors. Generally, this should take around 40 hours of individual work over the 2 years, but obviously that number is going to differ depending on the candidate, the student. We begin this in around October. So last two weeks ago, I met with our current year ones, our grade 11s, and introduce this to them as they're wide-eyed. It sounds a lot more daunting than it is, but it's something we want them to get started on and thinking about early, so they're not rushing at the as they head towards their, certainly their exams of their final year. The last part is the creativity, activity, and service. And I've already met with our year ones on this as well. These are three areas of extracurricular activity that students must do. It makes up roughly 150 hours, although it's based on outcomes and it's not actually based on hours, but it's about 50 hours each or so at a ballpark. And this is, encourages our IB students to be involved in things other than just their academics. That's really important. It's the education outside of the classroom that, you know, taps into their own personal, local, national, and international issues and helps to develop, again, all of those adjectives that make up that learner profile. So creativity is literally that, things that they create. If they are artistic in nature, musical, if they like to paint, draw, knit, build, any of those things could make up creativity experiences. The activity or action is essentially movement, sport, exercise. If a student plays on a school team, if a student plays on a local team, if a student has an exercise program, if a student creates a goal that they want to walk 10K, you know, by the end of the month, run a half marathon, whatever that is, something as simple as performing a 2-minute plank. They create a goal, they work towards that goal, they reflect on the journey, they reflect on their successes, their failures. Whether or not they achieve the goal is essentially irrelevant. It's very much about that journey along the way. They have to have a supervisor that can vouch that they've done these things, and they have to provide evidence. They put all of that into our Manage Back system that we train them on. They use Manage Back for CAS, for Extended Essay, and for TOK as well. The last part is the service component of CAS, and this is the volunteerism. This is giving back to the community in some way. This often coincides with the 40 hours of community service that the Ministry of Education asks for within Ontario. The difference there is that those volunteer hours can begin for the OSSD. A student can begin in grade 9. CAS hours cannot begin until after their grade 10 year. So a lot of the IB students, they might hold off on their volunteer hours because they will pick that up in grade 11 and 12, but certainly getting 80 hours, there's nothing wrong with that. So these are the subjects that we offer at GDHS. We do not offer every subject that IB makes available to us because of our population, but we believe this is a fairly strong balance for our current demographic of students. So in group one, language A, we offer the literature course. And in the right, on the right in the columns, you will see the OSSD credits that are earned through those IB courses. Okay. You'll notice in front of English, you'll see an HL. This stands for higher level. That means there's slightly higher expectations on the assessment and evaluations. But ultimately, it deals with the hours. A higher level course is 3 semesters in length, as opposed to a standard level course like you see in Group 2 Language B. We offer French at the standard level. There are 2 courses for that. So standard level courses, 2 semesters. Higher level courses, 3 semesters. You will note for French that we do offer the higher level, but that is only for our immersion students. Group 3, we have Individuals and Society, and we offer the standard level history. It's actually somewhat changed, I would argue. It's not history of the Americas so much anymore as we've gone from HL to SL. It's actually more of a world history course. Group 4, we have the experimental sciences. We have higher level biology and higher level chemistry. You will notice that physics does not exist there. We do not offer IB physics. We do offer physics in our general university stream. But if a student is an IB diploma student, they will have no room in their timetable to take the physics course. What most students do for that course, oh, I'm noticing we have a typo there for physics. I'm blown away that that has slipped by me as many times as it has. My apologies. What most of our students do, we have many students that are heading into engineering. They take the physics. They take the grade 11 physics, possibly in the second semester of grade 10 or in the summer between 10 and 11. And they take the grade 12 physics in the summer between grades 11 and 12. So although we do not offer it, most of our IB students do, in fact, take the physics. For group 5, we have mathematics. That is a standard level mathematics that grants them their advanced functions and their calculus and vectors course. You will notice that data management is not offered through IB. They will not get the data management course with IB math at the standard level. That's important to note for students that are possibly heading into a business degree. They will have to, again, pick up that data management online at some point in time. Group 6 is the arts or the elective. We offer the higher level visual arts only. We used to offer drama and music as well, but our numbers are just, students just weren't taking them. So the arts seem to be the one, especially for course students that are not necessarily diploma students, but are heading into architecture, art history, design. Having the three levels of art allows them to create their portfolio, which is often a requirement for admission to many university programs. So this seemed to fit really well. In lieu of the art, students have the option of picking up another course. So what students will do at Georgetown High, if they opt out of the art and their diploma, they will pick up the higher level chemistry. This seemed like a wonderful fit for most of our students. It allowed them to get their biology and their chemistry, as many students are heading into the sciences or health sciences. So this seemed to be a wonderful fit. And this is why we made this change that just started in September of 2021. And the last course that you see there is the TOK course, which grants them the philosophy credit HZT for you. And that occurs in their grade 12 year. So this is how we interpret IB grades. IB students are not marked out of 100 as our academic and university courses are. They're actually marked on a 7-point scale. We introduce the 7-point scale to students while they're in grades 9 and 10, so they become familiar with it for when they get to the IB program. And so if you think about it, you have a possible 7 marks for each of your major subject areas, of which there's 6. So if one was to achieve a 7 in all of those areas, that student would have a 42. There are 3 possible marks left for the TOK course and the extended essay, for a possible total of 45. A 45 out of 45 is considered a perfect score. We've had one student get a perfect score. Many get 44 out of 45. There's usually about 100 a year around the world that get a perfect score, 45. So we're very proud of the student that we did have, considering our small population of IB students at Georgetown High School. So we have the grades or points ranging from 7 down to an N. Students cannot achieve a 1 overall on a core subject. They could on an assignment, certainly, but not overall. They would not be eligible for the diploma if that was the case. And then we have the TOK course is graded from A to N. And once again, you could not get an N and achieve your IB diploma. So this is the table of equivalent grades that every IB school in Ontario uses. So on the left side, you notice the DP grade levels. So what happens is we grade IB students on the 7-point scale, and then we convert that grade into a percentage for essentially for their OSSD and for the students just to see what that percentage grade would be. So you'll notice a 7 ranges from 97 to 100, a 6 from 93 to 96, and a 5 from 84 to 92. The average grade of IB students at Georgetown High would fall under the level 5. And so there's a range there, 84 to 92. That's for teachers to decide based on the evidence that they've seen. Are they at the low end of 5, the high end of 5? We call that a -5, a 5, or a +5. But IB has nothing to do with minuses and pluses. So essentially, if a student scores a 5 on IB when all is said and done, that student would receive the mark at the top of that range. So a 92%. So these are some of the stipulations of the IB program and the stipulations in order to achieve the diploma. So as I stated, out of 45 points, as we know, 6 subjects for possible 7 points each, plus the 3 additional, make up the possible 45. Students must earn at least 24 points in order to earn their diploma. If they get 23, they will not be awarded the diploma. They still get their credits, but they will not be awarded the IB diploma. They cannot have a level 1 in any subject when that subject is completed. They cannot have more than 2 level 2s, no more than 3 level 3s or below. In their higher level subjects, they must have at least 12 points. And in their standard level subjects, they must have at least 9 points. So it does allow for some flexibility there, depending on the student's strengths and weaknesses. This would be the idea of a timetable for an IB student. This is not carved in stone. This is not exact. Some years courses will flip. Some years you will have possibly 2 English in grade 11, 1 in grade 12. Another year you may have, which is more common, 1 English in second semester of grade 11 and 2 in 12. You'll notice the multi-purpose lunch that is there. So all students that are diploma students will have lunch together. And that allows us some flexibility to do some lunchtime learning, whether that's meeting about CAS, extended essay, students can get together and work on something, study groups. It's just having that time together allows a little bit more flexibility for us from the administrative side to meet with students and such. So you'll notice if a student wanted to take physics, there's no available courses, no available time slots to do so. That's why that physics has to be taken in the summer and or online. So this is just there's a couple students here. We showed the different tracks. So this student was heading into engineering, took civics and careers online in summer school, the summer after grade 9, which is very common for our ALP students, because it frees up a course for them. It allows them to take an elective in grade 10, because in fact, they do have to pick up a second math in grade 10. So this student took grade 11 physics during a grade 10 year, grade 12 physics online. This student selected HL English, SL French, but opted out of the history and took higher level economics online through an IB accredited school called Pomoja. And it is in fact the only IB online accredited school. Students are allowed to take one Pomoja course over their IB diploma. And if a Pomoja course lasts for the full 2 years, grade 11 and 12. And there is additional costs on top of the IB cost to take a Pomoja course. They used to offer many scholarships, and most of our students only paid anywhere from $100 to $300. The Pomoja courses were very popular. But now they have removed most of those scholarships. And I think our costing now is close to $3,000 for the course. So it does become quite pricey. But it is an option. We've had other students opt out of the IB French here and have taken it through Pomoja, because the Pomoja course is what we call ab initio, meaning from the beginning, from the start. So it's a little lighter. So this student also took her mathematics and then opted out of the art and took the chemistry. You'll notice it says SL chemistry because, as I stated, up until this year, it was standard level chemistry, standard level art, and higher level history. But we've made that modification. This student received a substantial scholarship to the University of Waterloo and went into system design engineering. So this is a student that's more on the arts humanities track. So you'll notice a lot of commonalities, but this student took the HL history and opted to not take the chemistry and took the visual arts instead. So there is some flexibility depending on the program a student wants to head into. We do offer IB and French immersion for those people that don't want to give up their French immersion if they've been working at it for years and years. So there is an option there to get the immersion certification and an IB diploma. It does mean taking a course in the summer in French online, and that is generally the anthropology course that is offered in French online. So students will have to take that course in order to satisfy the immersion hours. But there is a pathway for this, so that's important to note. So IB costing. So right now, these are based on our 2021 costs for this year that were just invoiced. Most likely the cost will stay the same for next year, for 2022, although it cannot be guaranteed. So for the grade 9 and 10 ALP program, there is no cost at all. For grade 11 and 12, it is $2,700 for the full diploma. So that's $1,350 a year. And invoices are sent out in October. And payment is received in November. This is important because we cannot order and register students for exams without payment. If a student did not want to take full diploma, but wanted to take a few of the IB courses, a higher level course would cost $550. And a standard level course would cost $350. And virtually no money comes back to the school here. This is all paid off to IB. The licensing is very expensive. The exams are very expensive. And it covers any training costs that IB stipulates we must have for teachers. It also covers our licensing for programs like ManageBack that we use to upload information. So why IB? Well, as a program, we believe that it prepares students for post-secondary and the rigors of post-secondary. And that's certainly not to say that our OSSD courses don't do the same. We just feel that IB is a little bit different. It's more in line with exactly what they're going to see at the university level. It encourages students to think independently on their own. They drive their own learning, which is an important facet we know of post-secondary, a lot more independence. So they have more independence within the IB program while still in high school. They become more culturally aware, which we feel is very important, not just through the development of a second language, but also the kind of rich resources that that we use in IB, the texts that are studied from around the world. It is very much offers a more global perspective. As I stated, we do feel that it's outstanding university preparation, and many universities have spoken to this, that they love IB students. Some statistics show that IB students, generally their grades don't dip in first year as many other students do. We don't have that falling off before we generally have that gradual rise again. IB students tend to stay more consistent because they're used to the stresses that they see in post-secondary, the time management piece, the stress management piece, needing those incredible study habits, the research skills, the writing, critical thinking skills, and exam preparation. That's such an important part of the IB program. Students that are in our OSSD courses, their exams might only make up of a maximum 20% of their final grade. Where in IB, you could have exams worth 70%. Does that present a lot of pressure on our students or our children? It does. But they work together. They work with their teachers. They work with everyone in the program to manage that. And we try to ensure their success. And because of that, they're better prepared for what comes next. As I stated, there's an emphasis on analytical and critical thinking. And IB is recognized around the world. Most of the IB assessments and evaluations are done externally where grades are determined, which is that standardized piece, which is the idea in universities recognize. If this student earned a 6, this is a 6. They didn't get a six because they have a relationship with their teacher. They didn't get a six because someone was overly empathetic to them for some reason. They got a six because it was a six compared to all of the other students around the world that are in IB. And that's why a lot of universities embrace the IB student. Also, IB students get a second look from the university admissions officers. They get a look in February and again in April, where your OSSD students just get one look. We talked about that equivalent, the table of equivalent grades there. Scholarships, although they are many for IB students, it's important to note are not guaranteed. An IB education is not a guarantee of a scholarship. It's not a guarantee of university acceptance. That'll be based on what the student does within IB. In saying that, our students at Georgetown District High School have earned over $1.4 million in scholarships over the past 12 years, which is mighty impressive. We've had some absolutely fabulous students come through this program. And another possible plus is what we call advanced standing. And so some universities will give IB students first year courses because they have the IB education, because some schools are valuing the IB education almost in line with first year university courses. If a student gets a level 5 or higher, they will give them, him, her, or them, those credits. Not every school does this. Not every program in every school does this. This takes a great deal of research on the part of the family and especially the student, hopefully. We do not provide that research because there's too much. Every university is different. Even within the university, every program is different. So for example, you could be applying to McMaster University into business. And if you have a higher level English IB credit and you achieved a level 6, they may give you your first year English credit. But that same student applies to health sciences may not get that advanced standing. So it's completely dependent on the school. Every university on their admissions page has usually information about IB students. So that's where families and students want to go and do their research, call the school. Absolutely want to educate ourselves on the programs that we want and where we want to go. Some universities don't care at all. An IB education gets you absolutely nothing. That students are accepted based on their averages only. Okay, so again, that due diligence is important there. The research, one should definitely put his, her, their time into that. We have had students actually roll directly into second year courses. We're granted their entire first year. So it does happen. Okay, we've talked essentially about that. So in our 2019 class, as an example, 85% of our IB students achieved early acceptance, which is nice to have that off his, her, or their plate. As they head into that second semester and exams, they already know early acceptance quite early in semester one that they've been granted admission. And many of those graduates also enjoyed scholarships, varying from different amounts. Like we had, some students received $2,000. We had some students up to $60,000. And those were all universities in Ontario, even the $60,000. So just a quote from a UBC professor, IB graduates tend to be better prepared to adjust to the academic environment of higher education. And as I stated, there's a video on our website where an admissions officer talks about why they love and value an IB education. So a little bit about the ALP program. So this is our grade 9 and 10 program that is not affiliated with IB, but that we have created in order to better prepare our IB students. Students will reach ahead here, go a little bit deeper. The text may be a little bit more challenging. They're going to focus on critical thinking, problem solving, study skills that'll be necessary in the senior grades. They're going to be introduced to the 7-point marking scale and different IB terminology and IB style evaluations in the ALP program. some art that some IB students have created. So ALP, we backfill with gifted students as well. So gifted students don't have to make a decision. They can have the differentiation for gifted while at the same time getting the ALP education in case they want to head into IB for grade 11. So English, math, French, science, and geography, these students are clustered together. Then they'll have their physical education course, and then they'll have their electives. So they won't necessarily be together on their electives. And unfortunately, we haven't been able to run lunchtime music now because of COVID for a few years. But we hope to bring that back in the near future. In grade 10, students, as I mentioned earlier, will take two maths. First semester, they will have their academic math, grade 10. And the second semester, they will take the MCV math course, which is a grade 11 math, which helps prepare them for their IB math that they will actually have in grade 11. Most of the ALP students take the Civics and Careers online. This is a required course. They take it online between the summer of 9 and 10. My son is currently in grade 10 ALP, and he took that this summer, which he thought worked out very well. It was, you know, 1 month, and it was to take both the Civics and Careers. It was a few hours a day, but it allowed him to pick up a course of his choice, something that he wanted to take as an elective in this grade 10 year. So the same for grade 10 as 9. The difference is the geography's gone, and now we have a history in its place. And you'll notice if a student doesn't take the Civics and Careers online, they're only getting one elective in grade 10. Where if they take the Civics and Careers ahead of time, that number 7 course is freed up and they can pick something that they have a passion for. Transportation. This is a very important point. Currently, the Halton District School Board does not, I'll say that again, does not provide busing for IB or ALP students that live outside of the Georgetown District, for our purposes, the standard Georgetown District High School busing boundaries. For example, if you live in Acton and want to come to school at Georgetown District High School for IB, you will not be provided transportation. This is true if you live in Brampton. This is true if you live in Milton. There is no transportation provided. If you lived in Acton, however, you could apply for a courtesy seat because there is a bus that comes from Acton. But during COVID, those courtesy seats have stopped, and we don't know if they will come back into effect next September. So one has to prepare for getting to this school if you live outside of that busing boundary. The school does not coordinate private transportation. I do not coordinate private transportation. I do not coordinate parents, the sharing of information between parents to coordinate transportation. If you want to research the busing boundaries, you go to www.haltonbus.ca and you can find out if you're eligible for busing. We have another video here. This is specifically about the IB program that I made a few years ago. I had some university students come back and talk about their experience, which I thought was helpful.
On helping to develop your grades 11 and 12 years. So it prepares you for the actual IB program, and then it further on develops in the 11 and 12 senior years for university.
I'm a student here doing the IB program at GHS. I chose to do the IB program because I wanted to be in a room with people that actually cared about learning. Everybody just kind of wants to learn, and we're all here for the same reason, because we want to prepare ourselves further for university and just get as much out of our time here at GHS as possible. I think the most challenging thing about IB is going to be that we have so many exams all at the same time, and that we have to remember the same information over 2 years. So I think it's really important that we all learn to develop good study habits, because it's going to be definitely a difficult 2 years, but we all need to work together to make it great.
Why I love teaching IB? It's because it's a global perspective. It's about the concepts or the aims of the TOK course, which is similar. Think differently, think creatively, and think open-mindedly. And this is... These are aims and permeate the history class. It's aims and permeate the theory of knowledge class. It's the aims and permeate all of the courses in IB. It is why I love teaching.
Hi, my name is Anna. I'm a second year IB student in my first semester. And I would say that one of the biggest stresses of in IB is just the time management. You have a lot of activities going on at the same time, especially when you consider all the CAS activities you're doing on top of everything. CAS, for those of you who don't know, is Creativity, Activity, and Service, which is just another part of being an IB diploma student. And so the stress involved with that is sometimes you realize that there's things you can't get done, or you're running out of time. So it's all about talking with your teachers, finding out what works, and really just working together.
I'm Mara. I'm in second year IB in my first semester. The reason I joined IB is because I liked learning in an environment where the students were eager to learn and the teachers were committed to the students and having that kind of close-knit community. And so far, it's really been like that. And I've had friends around me and a class around me that is willing to help each other so we can all be successful as a class. And I've had teachers that are really there for me as a student and want me to succeed. Another reason I joined IB is because I liked looking long-term and trying to get ahead in university applications or even getting transfer credits into university. And so I found that through my course selection and through my commitment to those courses, I'm really able to become the best student I can when applying to university. And I'm also confident in my ability to do well once I get there.
My favorite thing about IB was just the class, the family aspect of everyone in the class, because you stick with the same people for a lot of the classes and you really get to know each other. And by the end of it, it really does seem like a family, because you work through everything together, you support each other, you go through everything together. And by the end, I think they're some of the best friends I've ever had, and I think I'll still know them for a long time.
When I got to university, not only were there a lot of other IB kids there that I was able to connect to really quickly, but now that midterms are coming up, I feel more prepared than I ever could have been. I have a lot of friends who are really stressed about midterms coming up because, oh my god, their midterms are, you know, worth 30 or 40% of their grade. And I've already been through something like that. I've been through exams within IB, which are worth a very big portion of my grade, like almost up to 80%. And so because of that, I don't feel as stressed as I might be if I hadn't gone through IB. And the fact that we had to go through all these courses at once really mimics the way that universities do it, where you learn a lot at once and you have to learn a lot on your own. And the same thing IB, you have to do a lot of learning on your own.
Yeah, and what I think is that IB prepares you in a different way. So, not through context. What I mean by that is, I don't think students of IB necessarily learn more than people say in academic level or university level. But they do learn other things like how to learn and how to take tests. So our kind of testing is more similar to the kind of testing that is done in post-secondary education, which really gives that advantage, especially in the terms when they're very soon, only like a month after school started. So that was really helpful. And how you learn as well, because the style of learning in university is very different from the style of learning in high school. And we learn kind of how to learn as well in IB. So I think that helps a lot.
When it comes to university, you're able to not just have an academic life and succeed academically, but you're able to actually have fun, have a social life, have a life outside of school, so that you're not just focusing yourself all onto your paper, all onto your books and studies, and you're actually enjoying your life.
Hi, my name is Karen Ristock, and I have been an IB teacher for 10 years, and I've been with the IB program since its inception here at Georgetown High School. And I was a proponent of having the IB program here because I thought it was a great opportunity for university preparation for students. It really helps them to learn the time management skills and the thinking skills that they need to go into university. But I love teaching IB, and I teach IB English, and I love teaching IB because it's a chance to work with students who are very interested and passionate about the subjects they're taking, who enjoy working together, and it's a chance to inspire them in my subject area, which is English, and to really challenge them to think more deeply and get better at things like analysis and the kind of thinking skills that they really need for university, but that they find out that they really enjoy to actually implement in their lives. So that's very good. I want something just like this.
Okay, so that's a little video that I made a few years ago. I hope that you could hear it. I will post the entire slideshow that will have the videos if the video sound wasn't very good or if it didn't go full screen for you. So you can check those out on our IB website as well. So we're going to move on to registration. So IB now and registration for ALP and or IB is now being done through a central online platform that is controlled by the Halton District School Board. So all interested parties, no matter what school they're applying to in Halton, will go through the HDSB portal. This will go live on October 30th, and the applications will close on December 4th. Those are important dates to remember. Applicants will be required to register and complete a few small writing tasks. And we really want the students to be doing the writing tasks, not the parents, as we do sometimes get, and it's sometimes a little bit obvious. We want students that want to be in these programs, that have a passion for learning. So we want to hear their voices in the application, please. Non-HDSB students will be required to provide evidence of academic standing. And so that means that the grade 7 progress report and the grade 7 final report and the grade 8 progress report will need to be uploaded with the application. If you are a current HDSB student, those things will be uploaded automatically. You will not have to do anything manually. And you will go through the HDSB website. Once you're in there, you will go to Learning and Resources, Secondary Education. Sorry, it's Secondary Education and Pathways. And then you'll see the International Baccalaureate link. Once you click that, you'll see two different tabs. One will say External Applicant, and the other will say Internal Applicant. So an internal applicant is any student that is currently in an HDSB school. If you are coming from Peel, if you are coming from Waterloo, you are considered an external student. And again, the key difference there is that the internal students will have their report cards automatically uploaded, and the external students will be given an option to upload. You will not be given admittance to the program without those progress reports and final reports being uploaded. Please do not take a photo and send it through that way. It is too difficult for me to see. You need to scan the document and upload it in that fashion. All right, the document needs to be scanned and uploaded and not a photograph, please. So students must review application and then click submit for it to be processed. Really important. The submit button must be clicked. Once this occurs, parents or guardians will then receive an email confirmation that the application has been submitted. Parents and guardians will be asked within that email to verify that they support the application. Because the assumption is that grade 8 students applying to grade 9 ALP are eventually heading into IB and there's a cost, we want to be sure that parents know what's happening. So if the parents do not support the application does not go through. Once this verification is complete, the application is formally submitted, and parents and guardians will receive a confirmation email. At this point in time, I can go in and I can see all of the applications and I can start working through those applications. If all of these steps are not followed, the application does not come to me, and therefore admittance to the program will not occur. It's important to note that you can only apply to one of the IB schools. And if you live within the area of an IB school, that is the IB school you need to apply to. You can't apply to Georgetown High because you have some friends here if you live next door to Craig Kielberger, as an example. So here's some important dates. We have October 30th, 2021. This is when the registration will open. It is not a race. We are an open program at Georgetown High for the most part, so it is not the first 30 students. We want as many students as we can get in the ALP system. If you do not make the first application and you're applying in February, if we open up again, there may be a chance that you will be waitlisted at that point in time, but generally, all students that meet the criteria are accepted in the first round. So those applications that open on October 30th will close on December 4th. January 18th, 2022, students will get a notification of acceptance. Okay. Or they will get a notification that they have not been accepted into the program. This will go to the HDSB student email account or the email account for external applicants that they provided. January 29th, students must then respond to say whether they are not they are accepting, okay, or they are skipping on the program. Remember, we have students that are applying to multiple programs. So students may be applying to IB and the iSTEM program as an example. They may be accepted into both, and that student will have to make a decision. So that's the reason why they may have to make a decision to decline the offer. Okay, so that's January 29th, accepting or declining the offer of acceptance. In the month of January, students will complete their option sheets at their grade 8 schools. Students that have applied for the ALP program, if this happens before you get your acceptance, you should be applying as an ALP student. External applicants have to register at Georgetown District High School and provide all the documentation that is necessary. You can find that information out by visiting our guidance department. Can't do it in person right now, unfortunately, so you have to do that online. But if you can't find what you're looking for, please call the guidance department. I am not a guidance counselor. So if it's guidance-related questions, you need to go through guidance. In February at some point of 2022, I will open up the second round of registrations, depending on numbers, for late applicants. If you have applied in the first round and you were not accepted, you will not be able to apply in the second round. And that's about it for the presentation tonight. This is normally when we start taking questions. But again, please reach out to me over email. And if you want a phone call, and I love to hear a voice, I'm old school. I love a phone call. So leave me your number and I'll get back to you as soon as I can. As I stated in the beginning, my name is Kyle Stewart. I'm the ALP IB coordinator at the school. I'm also the gifted cert at the school as well. All right. And I hope to see, or at least hear from many of you, and see the grade eights in the fall of 2022. Okay, take care. And thank you very much for listening. Have a good night.